Hello, friends. Good morning. It's actually 12:11 p.m. So, good afternoon. As you can see, I'm in my PJs, and that's okay because this is the Pyjama Channel. And anyway, it's Saturday morning, and anyway, I was doing other things. But anyway, listen. Today's video, it is unscripted, but I have to tell you guys something very important. This is the month of October. Check out who's behind me. Blessed Mother. And you know what the month of October means. Month of the Rosary. Ta-da! So guys, honestly, the more I pray the Rosary, the more I find this prayer is so powerful. It is so biblical. It will take you straight into the heart of Jesus through the heart of none other than his mother. Guys, I just honestly, okay, I'm just going to tell you, like, today, what I've started doing, thanks to so much inspirational content on YouTube, I've been able to pray 4 rosaries a day. And ideally, I like to pray them all together because then the meditation feels a bit more, what can I say? It gels better, and it just kind of, you know, it flows better because then I'm meditating on the entire life of Christ from a biblical perspective, from birth through to ascension into heaven and through to the assumption of the Blessed Mother. For those who may not know what I mean, I will explain. I will. So the rosary in its entirety is made up of 4 mysteries, okay? The joyful, which starts with the Annunciation, how the angel came to Mary, you know, the birth of Christ, his early childhood, what we know in scripture, okay? Not anything outside of that. The luminous mysteries, which were added by Pope John Paul II, Pope John Paul. John Paul, you know, John Paul, the one who reigned, like, from even before, slightly before I was born, I think, like, 79, I don't even remember, but I was not born. But anyway, one of the longest reigning popes and who had a deep devotion to Our Lady. He added those luminous mysteries, and these ones now are kind of focused on the public ministry of Christ. So, you know, his baptism, his very first miracle, which I will discuss just now. Our Lady was involved. His, you know, proclamation of the gospel, institution of the Holy Eucharist. Then the sorrowful mysteries. So this is really focusing on the passion of Christ, you know, from the agony in the garden through to his crucifixion and death. And then the glorious mysteries, his resurrection, through to returning to heaven. And then also, what we in the Catholic Church firmly believe to be true, the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, which makes a lot of sense, and her coronation in heaven as Queen of Heaven. All right, now, today, for example, as I was praying on the sorrowful mysteries, I was able to reflect on just the fruitfulness of suffering. You know, Jesus himself suffered deeply. And, you know, we just, now in these mysteries, we're looking at the agony in the garden that he went through when he was praying and the disciples were falling asleep and he was asking, Father, if it be your will, take this cup from me, but let not my will be done, let yours be done. What is so powerful about this is that we see Christ himself, who is God, okay? In Philippians, it says, Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, becoming as human beings are. That is 2 Philippians 6 and 7. So Philippians 2, chapter 2, verse 6 and 7. So basically, we see Christ doing what all of us human beings need so much to do, losing the ego. So he was Christ. He was perfect man, perfect God. He never had an ego, I guess, the way we would define it today. He was God, but he didn't put himself on the level of being too good for suffering, okay? And you know what happened is the fruitfulness, after all, okay, we were all saved by that. But then it allows you and me to begin to think, wow, the suffering, the little suffering in my life, honestly, I have to say, I am blessed. I am blessed. And I thank God every day for that. But there are times when my small mind, not talking badly about myself, but I'm telling the truth, when I begin to think, oh, I'm suffering so much, why do I have to go through this? I wish there was another way. There's so much fruitfulness in suffering. I'm just looking at my notes here because I was kind of writing it down as I meditate, as I was meditating. And, you know, there's no need also to pretend that we are not suffering. So much of social media is about, you know, the just the shiny parts of life. Huh? Somebody said it so well that we compare our behind the scenes and our editing to someone else's highlight reel, and then we get depressed. Okay, maybe not. But the point is, like, what we're seeing in fake life, social media life, is just all the good things, as though suffering doesn't exist, as though it's not a good thing. Wrong! It does exist, and it is a good thing. Get me right on this. I'm not saying that we go and seek suffering for its own sake. What I am saying is that there is divine purpose and merit beyond what perhaps our own minds can grasp in suffering. If Christ himself did it, there is a very deep, beautiful, meaningful, excellent, salvific, you know, just fantastic reason for it. Okay, and you know what? I didn't come to this myself. This rosary, praying and meditating on this rosary, brought me to that understanding. Okay, so I cannot recommend this enough, especially if any of you are suffering. Okay, we all are in one way or another. Please, this rosary is, it's so deep. And you know, as I was praying it, by the way, this scripture in Philippians came up, you know, and the rosary by itself is a biblical meditation. There are many Christians I know who say, if it's not in the Bible, it's not, doesn't matter. Okay, guess what? The rosary is all biblical. It is very, it will bring you to a level, you know, not of just reading the Bible like a book, but of meditating and of entering into that life of Christ. And we all need that. We need that mind of Christ, because you know that this place is a battle. You know that life is an ongoing spiritual battle, and we need a weapon. And one of the, I tell you, effective weapon par excellence, it's this. It just is. Right, so that was the first thing I wanted to tell you, that suffering, the meaningfulness of suffering, the importance of reflecting the rosary. Okay, the other thing I want to say, praying 4 rosaries a day, it is not hard. Believe me, it's not hard. There is such sweetness in it. I'll link a video below about Cristiano Slim. Now, we probably all have heard of Carlos Slim. He's like, you know, the world's wealthiest man in the world, like, really. His son, Cristiano Slim, prays 4 rosaries a day. And I won't rehash the video, but I'll just link it below so you can take a look. They've done it very well. What I wanted to say is that when I first got this idea of praying 4 rosaries, I struggled with it. So, like, I would pray, I used to pray one and think, oh, I'm doing so well, until I began to pray all 4. Then sometimes I would break it up. But I've been finding that the meditative aspect of it gets lost, because, like, sometimes I'm trying to pray it in a matatu, which is good. It is good to pray it. Sometimes I'm trying to pray it while walking. Wonderful. Just wonderful. Though for me, I need silence and I need concentration. And sometimes I would be praying, but it wasn't coming. By the way, not to say that Our Lady, this mother of ours, can't work with that. She understands. That's the beauty of her. Like, being a human being, you know, she, and being a mother, she gets it. She gets that not everybody has time, you know, all the time, every day. And she gets that our efforts are not perfect, okay? But she, believe you me, she takes it and she makes it into something. Remember that, what I was telling you about the miracle at Cana? Those people didn't have wine, right? They didn't. And she approached her son, and that answer of his is mysterious. He tells her, woman, what has this to do with me? My time has not yet come. Okay, but guess what? He still performs a miracle. And you know what she says in response to that? She just turns to the servants and she says, do whatever he tells you. And the thought came to my mind, like, she, queen and mother that she is, when you're subject to her, she is, you know, a king, queen. Jesus is king. He is. Guess who the queen is, okay? When you're subject to her, doesn't make you any less subject to Jesus. If anything, it makes you more so. And you know why? Because her command to you will be, do whatever he tells you. The same way she commanded those servants, and then they filled the jars with water, and then wine, like excellent wine. The chief steward who tasted it was like, oh, you know, it's the same thing. She will tell you to do whatever he tells you, and I promise you, it is not going to be hard. Saying the rosary, what I've come up with, like today, I timed myself. I started out with the first two mysteries, got distracted, started doing other things. Then I said, okay, the last two rosaries, I'm going to time myself. So I did. It took exactly 47 minutes, 51 seconds, something like that. So, but 47 minutes, something. And what I realized is, if I can say two rosaries in under an hour, that means four rosaries will be 2 hours, right? Four rosaries, 2 hours. So 47 minutes, call it 50 minutes times two, which is 100 minutes. So I said to myself, okay, I'm going to give 100 minutes every day. So call it the 100 minute challenge or something. I don't know. But this is my commitment, you know. And I've found in my prayer that whatever I give to Our Lady, man, she just multiplies it. Like, sometimes I feel I don't have time. Then I ask her to give me time later in the day, because maybe I need to practice the piano, for one, you know. Or I need to do other work, like this work. Even that I give to her. I've started to give all my problems, not really like, oh, I need a solution, but just like, here's this is a grace that has come to me. Here's the problem, you know, like, I'm having difficulties with this person. I'm having struggles with this issue. I need time in life, you know. I need finances for something or other. Honestly, I just give it like this. And you know what? I've been seeing that solutions. So outside of my own engineering and machinations, like, solutions, they come, and I am not shy to credit it to this, honestly. And it's not the beads in and of themselves, to her, like, behind me, it is the Blessed Mother. It's her powerful intercession. It's the grace of God. It is the grace of God. Again, whatever you do for Our Lady does not take away from Jesus Christ. After all, he created her. But I'm telling you, without her, I'm not joking, without her, I don't think you're gonna make it. Like, very, very, you may, honestly, you may, but it's going to be so much harder, so much more difficult. Like, I don't know, can I say that she's a shortcut? Like, does that sound bad? Like, I don't mean to be rude, Mother Mary, I really don't, or irreverent, but I'm telling you the truth, guys. Don't forget her, and you can access her through this. There are many other Marian devotions. By the way, I'm reading this book, Champions of the Rosary. It's an excellent book, a really, really good book. There's an excellent, like, beginning part about the origins of the rosary very deep. Like when Our Lady first gave it to Saint Dominic, he was struggling to preach, you know, against a lot of heresies in his time. And she said to him, "Don't wonder," I'm paraphrasing, "don't wonder that your efforts so far have been fruitless. You know, preach my rosary, preach my Psalter," is what she said. And Saint Dominic took the habit of, you know, say like preaching about a theological aspect, because at the time, just like today, so much misunderstanding. But then he would pray like a decade of the rosary while preaching, like as part of his preaching, within his preaching. And it worked. It worked. So many souls were converted. And more, to this day, like the rosary is very, very powerful. Padre Pio calls it the weapon of our times. And believe me, brothers, sisters, friends, we need a weapon. You're going out there into a battlefield. And worse is that the deception is so much so that many of us don't even realize we're deep within combat. And you need a weapon. You need a weapon. And this is the weapon. This is it. Now, I'm not calling myself a saint. I have too many struggles. Many times I'll finish the rosary and go and blow my top at somebody, you know, at home. Like, I don't do well with people. Okay, maybe I'll say like someone said, maybe I don't do perfectly with people but and life, but, you know, maybe I do well. And if I do, not my merit and God, it is the Lord. Another thing I wanted to just bring up, the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, again, from when biblical, at the beginning of creation, Genesis talks of the Spirit of God was moving over the, was it the waters? Or was the water created at the time? Bear with me. I'm just going to pull that up so that I don't induce people in error. So here, Genesis 1, in the beginning, God created heaven and earth. Now the earth was a formless void. There was darkness over the deep with a divine wind sweeping over the waters. Okay, that's what my translation says. My footnotes actually say this is not a reference to the Spirit of God. The creation is affected by the Word of God. Okay, fair enough. I think other translations have the Spirit of God was moving. I'm not here to debate that theologically. It just occurred to me that divine wind sweeping. Huh? When the Annunciation, during the Annunciation, we have, I think it's in Luke's Gospel. Again, don't making this video really long. But Luke talks of when Mary questioned, how will this be, you know, because I am a virgin. The angel, Gabriel, who appeared to her, said to her, the Spirit of God will overshadow you, and the power of the Most High will come upon you. So notice the role of the Holy Spirit there. Okay. Then when Jesus was baptized, we saw, like John witnessed, the Spirit of God descending upon him in the form of a dove. Notice the importance of the Holy Spirit, like at the beginning of important things, like creation, incarnation, when Jesus came to earth, start of his ministry, right? Which, by the way, those mysteries like Annunciation, this one of baptism of Jesus, they are in this rosary. They are there. Then even Pentecost, now the start, when the gospel began to be preached, the Holy Spirit came down and descended. Please, in fact, everything that can be done as a Christian, I promise you, it is through the Holy Spirit. You can't, without him, Jesus has told us, without me, you can do nothing. That's what Jesus said. And he said that I'm going ahead now, when he ascended, to prepare a place for you. And also, I will send you an advocate. He talked, this is somewhere in John's Gospel. As someone, the Blessed Mother, who, you know, the angel said to her, hail, full of grace. That's number one. She's full of grace, full of the grace of God. Nothing that she does is outside of God. It is by God's grace. The angel also told her that the Holy Spirit will overshadow you and the power of the Most High will come upon you. guys, she's someone who has the spirit. I'm not saying that other people don't have it, but as the one who actually was connected to Jesus in the most intimate way possible, from the very beginning to the cross when he died, to the resurrection, to the assumption, and now even in heaven, she gets it, okay? And she can help you. Okay, this has been a very long video. If you don't mind, I'm going to end it by saying this Holy Spirit prayer. This was given to me by a lovely lady named Phoebe, if she's watching. Did I say Phoebe? No, Lillian. Lil, if you're watching, thank you. This prayer goes like this, in the name of the Father and Son of the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, replace the tension within us with a holy relaxation. Replace the turbulence within us with a sacred calm. Replace the anxiety within us with a quiet confidence. Replace the fear within us with a strong faith. Replace the bitterness within us with the sweetness of grace. Replace the darkness within us with a gentle light. Replace the coldness within us with a loving warmth. Replace the winter within us with your spring. Straighten our crookedness. Fill our emptiness. Dull the edge of our pride. Sharpen the edge of our humility. Light the fires of our love. Quench the flame of our lust. Let us see ourselves as you see us, that we may see you in yourself and in others as you have promised. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. Amen. Just as I was praying that, another thing that came to mind, I know this video is long, but I just, honestly, it is the spirit. I think I'm set on fire. Problems of life, things like addictions. I think what came here is quench the flame of our lust. Lust is such a, I think it's rampant. And the worst thing about it is that, unlike other addictions, I guess all addictions are shameful, but this one, sexual shame, I think is particularly prevalent. So people don't want to discuss it, and people don't want to bring it into the light for it to be healed. The rosary is a very powerful tool to overcome addictions. There's a guy named Matt Frad who had terrible addictions to pornography, etc. And he overcame. Today, he's like a very good, he's an excellent speaker. And he credits his overcoming it to the Holy Rosary. Many, many people have been helped by praying the Rosary, whether it is substance addictions, whether it is, nowadays we have device addictions. I'm a witness and I'm praying about that, you know, social media addictions. People, wield this weapon, wield this weapon. Once again, just to recap, you know, things about this video that I want people to take. Number one, the power of meditating with the Holy Rosary, the powerful, powerful presence of God in this rosary, the powerful intercessory power of our Blessed Mother, Mother of God, Mother of Christ, help of Christians, all Christians, really, it's here, it's in the rosary. Please remember it. Remember that it's a weapon. It's a very powerful weapon to defeat any problem. She herself said there is no problem that cannot be solved by the recitation of the Holy Rosary. Yes, it's true. Very highly biblical. Biblical meditation par excellence. It's all here in these beads, in these mysteries. The time it takes, maybe you can do it in less, but I'm suggesting 100 minutes. Give 100 minutes of your day to pray the entire 4 mysteries of the rosary. Do it as you can, as you know how I do it, but my suggestion to you is, in terms of time, try 100 minutes and give that. If you can't, start even with 1 decade, then do the full rosary, then do 2, and so build up. You can do it that way too. Power of the Holy Spirit. Don't forget the Holy Spirit. In fact, he will come to you through prayer and through the Holy Rosary. He really will. Okay, guys. So I wanted to talk about what I'm wearing around my neck. I think I'll do that in another video, another time. So I love you guys. Thank you so much for making it through to the end of this long video. One love, God's love, peace with you. May the Blessed Mother, full of grace, pray for you and be a mother to each and every one of you. Amen.